Hello viewers, good day to you all, and you are welcome to our today's lesson on science for grade 7, and the topic is ecology. And the subtopics that we shall be discussing on the ecology here is definition of ecological terms and interrelationship between organisms in the ecosystem. So these are the subtopics that we shall be discussing today. So we start with an introduction to what is ecology. So let's look at this picture here we have seen in this, on the screen, and some of the statements we have alongside. As we saw there, clownfish interact with sea animals in a manner that is positive to both. The sea animal provides protection and nutrients to the clownfish. In return, clownfish fecal matter provides nutrients to the sea animal. So as you can see in the picture here, you have a fish called clownfish and another organism that is called sea animal. And they are having an interaction there. The sea animal one way depends on the clownfish, and the clownfish also in another way around depends on the sea animal. And even together with their environment where they live, the water in which they live and everything around them, it's an interaction, okay? Good. So this brings us to definition of ecology. Definition of the term, ecology. So what is ecology in short? Ecology is the study of how organisms interact with each other and their environments. Ecology is the study of how organisms interact with each other and their environment, as we just demonstrated from the introduction there, the clownfish and the sea animal are living together in a particular habitat or environment, and they are interacting with each other together with the environment in which they live. So that is what is called ecology. So please try to know that definition from today. Okay. So now let's look at this also. Levels of biological organization. Levels of biological organization. So under ecology, according to biological organization, there are stratas or levels into which ecology is divided. So starting from the first level, which is the smallest level, that is the organism level, the organism. Then from the organism, we have what is called population. And the population is a group of the same organisms that live together in the same habitat or environment. That's called a population. Organisms that look the same or that are related and they can interbreed to produce young ones belong to the same population. Then from a population, we have what is called a community. That's what you are seeing there here now, a community. It involves different kind of living, things living together in a particular habitat, or plants and animals living together in a particular habitat. As you can see from this picture here, the organism here is an animal, it's a deer. We have other organisms likewise, the butterfly, the bats, and other organisms like plants and fungi. All these are living things. Some are plants, some are animals. So a group of them living together in a particular habitat is what is called a community. From the community level, we have what is called the ecosystem. Now, this is the highest level and is the biggest level of the ecological classification, ecosystem. And this is a combination of the living and non-living factors in an environment. So as you may see from this picture here, we have different components in this picture here. We are seeing sunlight, not so. We saw rainwater, we saw air, and also organisms. Some are plants, some are animals. So all of this together forms what is called ecosystem, the living and the non-living aspects of an environment forms the ecosystem, and is the highest level in the under biological organization, under ecology. Okay, so try to know this as well, please. Levels of biological organization, starting from the smallest level, organism, then moving to population, then community, and then the highest level is the ecosystem. Okay, so now we look at each of these terms that we saw there and try to describe or define them. Okay, so as we saw from the previous slide, the first level of biological organization under ecology is what is called organism. So what is an organism now? Any individual that has all the characteristics of life is what is called an organism. Any individual that has all the characteristics of life. This includes animals, plants, or microorganisms. All these things, we refer to them as organisms. Why? Because they have the characteristics of life that include movement, respiration, excretion, reproduction, nutrition, sensitivity, and the rest. Okay? So, from the organism, we have what is called population. Population under ecology. What is ecology? Sorry, population under ecological terms. A group of organisms of the same species that live in the same geographic area. This is what is called population. A group of organisms of the same species. The same species, take note. The same species that live in the same geographic area. This is what is called population. So as you may see from the picture still, look at these organisms. Are they not all the same? Obviously, they are all the same. They look alike. They belong to the same species. So a group of these organisms living together here will form what is called a population. These organisms are what are called dias. So we call this a dia population. Apart from the animals, we also have plants here. So a group of the same plants living in this particular habitat will form a population as well. For example, if you should have mangoes here, so a group of those mangoes here will form a mango population. If you should have palm trees here in this picture, the group of the palm trees will form the palm tree population. Okay, so remember now, a population is a group of organisms of the same species that live in the same geographic area. So remember now, what are the characteristics of a species? What do you remember about a species? What is a species? We talked about species here and we said a species is organisms that are the same or related and they can interbreed and produce young ones. These are called species. Example of species is human beings. Human beings belong to the same species because human beings have the same genetic makeup and they can interbreed to produce young ones. Okay? So we call this as a species. So try to remember that also. All right? So from species, population, we look at community. We look at community. What is community under ecological terms? Community. All of the populations that live in the same geographic area will form the community. All of the populations that live in the same geographic area forms what is called community under ecology. So look at the picture again still. We have seen animals here in this picture. This idea is an animal. We have seen a butterfly, it's an animal. We are seeing birds, which are animals. But also, there are plants also. Plants are there, and some other organisms like the fungi is also an organism, type of organism. So a group of these organisms living together here form what is called a community. So in other words, you can also define a community as all the plants and animals living in a particular geographic area. All the plants and animals living in a particular geographic area is a community. Or as we see from our own screen here, all the populations that live in the same geographic area is what is called community. Okay? So try to remember that also. Now we look at another level that is called ecosystem. What is an ecosystem under ecological terms? Ecosystem. So we say this refers to all the living organisms, that is a community, and the non-living organisms in a habitat. This is what is called ecosystem. This refers to all the living organisms, which include the communities and the non-living organisms in a habitat. It also refers to the biotic and abiotic factors. Ecosystem also refers to the biotic and abiotic factors. What are biotic factors? Biotic factors are the living factors in an ecosystem. What are abiotic factors? The abiotic factors are the non-living factors in an environment or in the ecosystem. So looking at this picture still again, we are seeing living aspects here and also non-living components. The non-living components that are called abiotic factors include the sunlight, the water, that's rainwater here you see, the air, are the non-living factors, and we call them abiotic factors. The living factors are the animals and the plants. The animals are part of the living factors, likewise the plants are also part of the living factors. We call them the biotic factors. So ecosystem, in short, is the biotic and abiotic factors in a particular habitat or environment. Or as we just saw from the other definition, it refers to all the living organisms and the non-living organisms in a particular habitat. Please, so take note of these definitions as we just learn them. Okay, so let's look at these terms and some of their examples as we just discuss them. Now we see biotic versus abiotic factors. Okay, what are biotic factors? Biotic factors, we say these are the living factors in an environment. The living factors in an environment. And some examples of biotic factors in an environment include animals, plants, fungi, bacteria. All these things are living organisms. So they fall under biotic factors. The abiotic factors, as we just mentioned before, are the non-living factors in an environment. The non-living factors in an environment is referred to as abiotic factors. And the examples of abiotic factors, as we see here, are sunlight is a non-living factor, water is a non-living factor, temperature, how hot or cold a particular place is, nutrients, and also soil. All these things fall under abiotic factors. Why? Because they are non-living factors in the environment. Please. So these are what I refer to as biotic and abiotic factors, and they are examples. So take note of them. If you should be asked to give examples of biotic factors, you should be able to do that. Okay? If you are asked to give examples of abiotic factors, likewise, you should be able to do that, as you see from the list here. Okay? So we can still move ahead. Now we have come to a broader term also under ecology that is called what? Biosphere. Biosphere. What will explain to you what is this biosphere? What is a biosphere? So just try to break the word down. We have already learned some of these ideas already. What is bio? We have learned this from the definition of biology. If you can remember that, biology is the study of life or living things. Biology is the study of life or living things. And we know from Latin, bio means what? Life, already. Okay, bio means life. So now when we say biosphere, what should we mean by that? It means the part of the earth where life exists or that supports life. Biosphere. The part of the earth that supports life or where life exists. Okay? So try to always remember that. Alright, so we have seen the picture here. What is this picture? This picture is showing us our planet and is the earth. Our planet earth. So this is showing you that our planet earth is a biosphere. Why? Because it has certain components that can support life. That is water and air. The blue areas you see on this picture are waters, like the rivers and oceans, and also we have air. So our earth is a biosphere because it can support life because of the presence of air and water. Okay? Now, as we show the definition now, biosphere, now we say this is the part of the earth in which life can exist, or part of the earth that supports life. So try to remember this now. Biosphere, this is the part of the earth in which life can exist, or the part of the earth that supports life. Please, okay? So let's look at this picture also. It is still a visual of a what? A biosphere. Look at the components here. We are seeing different components here. We have air, and we have organisms living in the air. That's the birds. We have water, and we have organisms living in the water there. And we have the land. All this include the land. And we are seeing organisms also living there. So each of this part of the earth can support life. Living organisms can live in the air, like the bats. Some living organisms can live in the water, just like you see them, some sea creatures. Marine organisms all live in the water. Some live inside the soil. As you can see from the diagram here, animals on the ground, okay? Dead plants and animals, some live on the land surface. Okay, we have also plants living on the land. So the land is also part of the biosphere. So far, it can support life. I hope you understand this, okay? So we may move. Another picture is showing us another type of biosphere, which is on the land now, and this is a forest. And the forest is a particular biosphere. Why? Because a lot of living organisms live in the forest. So why are they able to live there? Because the forest can support life because of there are certain things there, like water and air, that can support life for living things there. So it's part of the biosphere, please. Okay. So before moving further, let's try to look at some few questions just to test our understanding of the ideas we have just learned from the lesson. Okay. So the first question we have here is, groups of different species living together and interacting in the same environment are referred to as a, option A, organism, option B, community, option C, ecosystem, and option D, population. What should be our correct answer for this question? Groups of different species living together and interacting in the same environment are referred to as A. Okay, the correct answer here is option B, that is called community. Option B, that is called community. I hope you get that. So we can move on. Question two, all of the following are abiotic factors except, all of the following are abiotic factors except option A, algae, option B, pH, that is how the acidity or alkalinity of the of a particular substance or place or soil, C, temperature, and D, nutrients. Which of these are not part of the abiotic factors? Okay, if you can remember what is an abiotic factor. What is an abiotic factor? This is the non-living factors in an ecosystem. Or we say these are the non-living factors in an ecosystem. Okay. So out of these options here, which option do you think is the correct answer? Our correct answer should be option A, which is algae, because algae are biotic factors because they are living. So algae are living things. They are not part of non-living things. Okay? So they fall under biotic but not abiotic factors. The rest are all abiotic factors because they are non-living components in an ecosystem or an environment. Okay? So we can move still. Let's look at question three here, which says, which of the following levels of biological organization includes both abiotic and biotic factors? Which of the following levels of biological organization includes both abiotic and biotic factors? Option A says species, option B population, option C community, option D ecosystem. What should be the correct answer here? Which of the following levels of biological organization includes both abiotic and biotic factors? The correct answer will be option D. Option D, ecosystem. This includes the abiotic and biotic factors in an ecosystem. Okay. So if that is understood, we still move ahead in the lesson, and we have another term on the ecology that is called what? Habitat. A habitat. What is a habitat? Then let's try to do something that will make us understand what is a habitat. For our today's lesson now, we are going to involve a walk around the school compound and a field trip to different areas around the town, like forest, pond, lake, or lake, to make our own observation and collect data. So you get ready for that and we start moving, okay? So here we are now. We have reached some of our locations already. Now we are at the outskirts of the town, and here is a forest. And in this forest now, what are we seeing? We are seeing different types of organisms. We see a parrot, we see monkey also. We are seeing butterflies and some other insects. We are seeing tiger. We see other animals. This looks like a pig. And we have plants as well, and other different organisms. Okay? So all these things are living here. So this place can be referred to as their habitat. Okay, some live on top of trees, as the bats you see and the monkeys. Some live on the ground, as some of the animals you see here, the tigers. But we are also seeing water here. And the water is a lake. And in the lake, also there are different organisms that live in the water as well also. So this water also there is a habitat for other different organisms. Okay, so this is a forest. All right, we are seeing snake also on top of a tree there. So it's a habitat for him, for it, because it lives there. Okay. So we have seen all this also from our field trip. We have seen bats in their nest, animals sleeping at their places. Also, as we see bats, and we have seen chameleon, okay, monkey, and different other organisms. Okay, so all these organisms are living in their habitat. Okay. We are here also now. We are now at a pond or a lake. And also we see organisms. We are seeing organisms living in the pond or the lake. We are seeing a plant that is called water lily. A crocodile, we saw it. Okay. Hippopotamus and fish. So all these organisms are living in this water. So this water is part of their habitat. It's part of their habitat. Okay. Now we are in the town now, and you can see the environment clearly. Okay, so the town also, which is on the land surface, is a habitat because people live here. So it's a habitat for people. Okay, please. As we are seeing going around, we find people in their houses and they live there comfortably. Why? Because it's their habitat, it's their natural home. People lying on their beds and in their houses. So it's their natural home, that's where they live. Okay, so now this brought us to now, what is a habitat? How do we define a habitat now from the experience we have from the field trip outside? Now, what do you understand by the term habitat? What is a habitat? Now, as we see now, the term habitat describes the specific area, including biotic and abiotic factors, where an organism lives within an ecosystem. The term habitat describes the specific area, including biotic and abiotic factors, where an organism lives within an ecosystem. We said a habitat is like an organism's home within an ecosystem. So looking at the picture here, this is demonstrating an ecosystem. And within this ecosystem, we have different habitats, just as we saw from our field trip. Some organisms have the ability to live in the water. So the water is part of their habitat, or is their habitat. Some organisms live in the air. So it is their habitat. Some organisms live on the land. So the land is their habitat. So we said a habitat is like an organism's home within an ecosystem. Okay? I hope you understand that. So a broader definition of habitat, we say it's a natural home of living organisms. These organisms obtain most of their important needs, such as food, water, shelter, etc., from their habitat. So naturally, where an organism lives is called its habitat. Simply, it can get food from that place. It can get water, likewise, shelter, and other things that are necessary for its life. Okay? Yes. Now we look at types of habitat. Types of habitat. When we went around for the field trip, we saw different types of habitats. Some were living in the air and trees. Some organisms were living on the land. Some were living in the water. So all these are types of habitat for living organisms. So now, as we know, there are different types of habitat in which organisms can live. They are, one, terrestrial or land habitat. Terrestrial or land habitat. This includes forest, grassland, desert. Two, aquatic or water habitat. Aquatic or water habitat. And three, arboreal habitat or tree habitat. Arboreal habitat or tree habitat. Okay, so these are the three types of habitat. Try to remember them all the time, please, in case you'd be asked, you should be asked. Okay. Now let's look at each of them in broader terms and explain. One, we look at terrestrial habitat. or with that we call land habitat. Terrestrial simply means what? Land. So you can say terrestrial habitat, or you can say land habitat. It is all the same. We say it's a habitat that includes the forest, grassland, and desert. A terrestrial habitat or land habitat is a habitat that includes places like forest, grassland, and desert. All these are on the land, and they form habitat for different organisms. Example of organisms that live on land or that are terrestrial organisms, as you saw, are man, cow, lion, cat, pigs, camel, lizard, and some plants like mango tree, coconut tree, palm tree, baobab tree, etc., etc. So these organisms are terrestrial organisms simply because they live on land. Okay? So try to remember that also all the time. Two, we look at aquatic or water habitat. Aquatic refers to water. Aquatic means water. Okay, so we can say aquatic habitat, or we just say water habitat. And this includes rivers, sea, lake, etc. Aquatic or water habitat include river, sea, lake, even streams and ponds are all part of aquatic habitat. Examples of aquatic organisms are fishes, dolphin, whales, crocodile, alligator, hippopotamus, and some plants like water lily. So these organisms are called aquatic organisms simply because they live in water. Okay? Then the third type of habitat is the arboreal habitat. Arboreal habitat. This includes the air, trees, etc. Arboreal habitat include the air and the trees. Organisms live in the air and some live on trees. Example of arboreal organisms are bats in their nests, bats, parrots, monkeys, chameleons, some insects, etc., etc. These organisms are arboreal. Why? Because they have the ability to live in the air or on top of trees. Now, basically, these are the three types of habitats, so always remember them, please. Terrestrial habitat, or land habitat we call it, aquatic or water habitat, and also arboreal habitat, please. Okay? So we can move ahead now. We come across another very important term on the ecology now, and this is called ecological niches. Ecological niches. Okay? So what is an ecological niche? An organism's niche is a description of the role it plays in its habitat. An organism's niche is a description of the role it plays in its habitat. A niche includes all aspects of where and how an organism lives, including the type of food it eats, how it obtains food, where it lives in its environment. This could be tree, nest, or hive. When and how it reproduces. Please, so try to understand this concept here or term, ecological niches. I just go over it quickly. An organism's niche is a description of the role it plays in its habitat. A niche includes all aspects of where and how an organism lives, including the type of food it eats, how it obtains food, where it lives in its environment, either a tree, nest, hive, etc., when and how it reproduces. So these things describe an organism's niche, the type of food it eats in its habitat, how it obtains food from its habitat, where it lives in its environment, whether it is a tree or a nest or hive, and also when and how it reproduces, describe the organism's niche in its habitat. Please. Okay. Still continuing. A population's habitat answers the question, where do you live? Habitat. Remember that we just discussed it for some few minutes ago, habitat. A place where an organism lives. or the natural home of an organism is its habitat. So it answers the question, where do you live? But an organism, a population's niche, answers the question, how do you make a living? How do you make a living? Okay, so going back to our slide, how do you make a living is determined by the type of food we eat as an organism, how the organism obtains food, where it lives, and also when and how it reproduces, answers the question, how do you make a living? And that describes the organism's niche in its habitat. I hope you must understand that now. Okay? Now let's look at a simple demonstration about ecological niches. But first, let's look at these statements here. No two species can occupy the same niche in the same environment at the same time. This is called niche overlap. When this occurs, competition for resources will displace one of the species. Now, the figure below shows three different species of warblers that have established different niches in the same tree. So we are seeing here three different species of birds that are called warblers, okay? And they occupy or live in the same habitat, that's the tree now. But they occupy different positions in this tree here. They occupy different areas based on their feeding habit and how they reproduce, okay? So one of the warblers, that is called yellow rump warbler, feeds in the lower part of the tree and so at the base of the middle branches, okay? So that's its niche there. Now, this organism, it lives at the bottom of the tree. At the bottom part of the tree, that's its niche, that's where it occupies to make its living. Then another type of warbler, bay-breasted warbler, this one feeds at the middle of the tree. It lives there and feeds there and reproduces there. So that's its niche in that, in this habitat. The other type, Cape May warbler, live and feed at the tip of the branches near the top of the tree. So this other warbler species lives at the top of the tree. That's where it can obtain its food, and that's where it can reproduce. So that forms its niche in this habitat. So I hope this will explain better to you what is ecological niche. Okay, so we may proceed. So we also come now across another very important concept under ecology, and we call this food chain. Food chain, okay? So what is a food chain? This is the linear feeding relationship between organisms in a habitat. A food chain is a linear feeding relationship between organisms in a habitat. The animals in an ecosystem get food by eating each other or eating plants. The plants get food by using the energy from sunlight in photosynthesis. All the food in the ecosystem is made by the plants. The plants are the producers of food for the whole community. So remember now, plants are producers. They produce food for the whole community. They make their own food through a process called photosynthesis by using energy from the sun together with sunlight and water. The plants convert energy from sunlight into chemical energy in food. They will store some of this food, often in the form of starch. Starch, okay? When the plant needs, plants need energy, for example, to build new cells, they can release some of the energy in their food stores by the process of respiration. So from this simple explanation here, what you need to understand here is plants make their own food and they are referred to as producers. So they produce food for the whole community. Okay, how do they make food? By photosynthesis, using light energy from the sun together with sunlight and water and carbon dioxide. Okay. Still continuing on food chain, animals get their energy by eating food containing chemical energy. They eat food that has been made by plants. Animals are consumers. Now also remember that now also. Animals are consumers. Why? Because they eat food produced by plants, or they eat other animals. An animal that eats plants is a what? A herbivore or primary consumer. An animal that eats plants is a herbivore or primary consumer. Primary consumer here means first consumer, because they feed directly on plants. An animal that eats primary consumers is a carnivore. Is a carnivore or secondary consumer. Secondary consumer means second consumer. They feed on the primary consumers. An animal that eats secondary consumers is a tertiary consumer, third consumer, tertiary consumer. So try to remember these concepts here we just learned. What are consumers? What are herbivore or primary consumers? What are carnivore or secondary consumers? And what are tertiary consumers? We'll come across these terms as we move ahead still, but just try to remember them, please. Okay, still continuing on the food chain, we can show how the sun's energy is passed from plant to animal and to the next animal by drawing a food chain. A food chain shows how energy is passed along from one organism to another. How energy passed from one organism to another is demonstrated in a food chain. Okay? Food chains always begin with a plant. So always remember this portion here. Food chains always begin with a plant. Why? Because plants are the producers. I think we just mentioned this before. The arrows in a food chain show the direction of energy flow from one organism to the next. So the way you see the arrows move shows you how energy flows from one organism to the next. The producers, which are the plants, produce their own food. And some of the energy is transferred to a primary consumer that will feed on the producer. Now, some of the energy in the primary consumer also is transferred to the secondary consumer when the primary consumer is eating. And some of the energy also in the secondary consumer is transferred to the tertiary consumer when the tertiary consumer is the secondary consumer. So the movement of the arrows, or the direction of the arrows, shows how energy flows from one organism to the other in the food chain. Is that understood? I hope so. Okay. Still continuing on the same idea, food chain. So we have examples of food chain now. Depending on the situation, food chains may consist of 2, 3, 4, or 5 organisms. So a food chain can consist of at least 2 organisms or more, up to 5 organisms, but not only one. One organism alone cannot form a food chain. This is why we call it a chain now, because it cannot be formed by one organism, but at least 2, 3, 4, or even 5 organisms. So as we see from the examples here, the first example is rice and man. Rice here is the plant, is the producer, and it produces food and transfer energy to man when the man is the rice. Okay, so here energy is transferred from the rice to the man. Okay, so it's a food chain as far as it consists of 2 organisms. The second example, groundnut is a producer. Why? Because it's a plant. And energy transferred from the groundnut to rat. Rat is the primary consumer. And then energy transferred from rat to cat, which is the secondary consumer. Okay? The third example, grass is a plant, it's a producer. Then it can transfer energy to the antelope, which is a primary consumer. The antelope also can provide energy to dog. When the dog is the antelope, the dog is a secondary consumer. And the dog can transfer energy to the lion when the lion is the dog. And now the lion is the tertiary consumer. Okay, please. Now, the fourth example, again, we have grass. It's a producer. It produces its own food. And the grasshopper can eat the grass, and energy from the grass can be transferred to the grasshopper as a primary consumer. The lizard can eat the grasshopper as a secondary consumer, and energy from the grasshopper is transferred to the lizard. The snake can also eat the lizard, and energy in the lizard is transferred to the snake. The hawk can also eat the snake, and energy from the snake can be transferred to the hawk. Okay? So these are examples of food chain. It can consist of two organisms or more. All right? So we can move on still. Now we look at some of the definitions we have on the ecology. Okay? Definition and example of terms associated with the food chain. Associated with the food chain. All right? So most of them, we have already come across them, just repeating them, so try to remember them now. One, we have producers. Producers. What are producers? These are plants that produce their own food through photosynthesis. Producers are plants that produce their own food through a process called photosynthesis. All green plants are producers. So remember that, we just mentioned that also some time ago. All green plants are producers and form the base of all food chain, just as we saw from the examples. Plants always form the base of a food chain. They are they start. All food chain must start with a plant, producers. So try to remember that concept from today. Okay. Now we have another term called consumers. Consumers. What are consumers? These are animals that eat other animals and or plants. This is why we call them consumers, because they eat other animals or they eat plants. We call them consumers. Consumers may be divided into. These are the categories of consumers. We have three types of consumers. The first consumer, primary consumers. Primary consumers. And the primary consumers can be herbivores and they can be omnivores. Herbivores are organisms that eat plants, but omnivores are animals that eat both plant and animal. Example of primary consumers include grasshopper, cow, horse, rabbit, deer, man, pig, elephant, antelope, goat, sheep. These organisms here can be referred to as primary consumers. Why? Because they feed directly on the producer. They feed directly on the producer, which are the green plants. Okay? We have another type of consumers called secondary consumers. Secondary consumers. And secondary consumers are mostly carnivores. Are mostly carnivores. Carnivores are animals that eat meat. Example is the cat, is a cat, dog, leopard, etc., etc. These animals can be referred to as secondary consumers, and they are carnivores, okay, because they feed on the primary consumers. The third type of consumers are called tertiary consumers. Tertiary consumers, okay. Example of tertiary consumer can include lion, tiger, hawk, etc., etc. Tertiary consumers feed on the secondary consumers. Secondary consumers feed on the primary consumers. Okay? Another term on the food chain is omnivore. What is an omnivore? Omnivore. They feed on both plants and animals. So we say omnivores are organisms that feed on both plants and animals. They can be both primary and secondary consumers. So try to know that. Omnivores can be both primary consumers or secondary consumers, depending on the situation. Example is human being. Human being is an omnivore. Why? Because human beings can eat plants, they can eat animals. Okay? Then four, we have scavengers. Scavengers. What are scavengers? These are animals that feed on dead animals or carrion. Animals that feed on dead animals or carrion are referred to as scavengers. Examples of scavengers include vulture, crowbat. They are scavengers because you can mostly see them going around, roaming about, and feeding on remains of dead plants, dead animals. Okay? Then five, we have decomposers. Decomposers. What are decomposers? These are organisms that break down organic matter. What is organic matter? Organic matter is plant and animal products. Plant and animal products are organic matter. Okay? They feed on dead organisms to cause decay and thereby playing an important role in the recycling of essential nutrients, okay, in nature. Examples are bacteria and fungi. They are very important decomposers in nature. They help to break down the bodies of dead plants and animals, that is organic matter. And in the process, some essential nutrients are returned back to the soil for plants to use for growth again. So this is why decomposers are very important in nature. They help in recycling of essential nutrients in nature. Is that understood?